So we were discussing about the quantum states. So we broadly said that if you have quantum states, we can have two types of states. Okay, so what we are familiar so far are called pure states. Okay, so these are basically, in quantum mechanics, we are familiar with ket vectors or kets, or you can say they are elements of a Hilbert space. And usually denoted by something like this. Then we have in states that can be called as mixed states, and mixed states are essentially ensembles. So they are described by density operator. Density operators are matrices. And for pure states, there is a one-to-one correspondence between for pure states or for pure state psi. The corresponding density matrix of the density operator you can write it as rho as an operator is given by the projection operator. So there is a one-to-one correspondence. For every ket, you can write a density matrix. And so mixed states don't have, so mixed states cannot be represented as elements in the Hilbert space. So mixed states are operators acting on the elements of the Hilbert space. Okay. And we have seen that rho is a density operator. Okay, so a density operator density operator rho must satisfy the following properties. The first property is that trace of a rho has to be equal to 1. And then the second property is rho dagger is same as rho. That means Hermitian. It should be Hermitian. And third property, we write it as rho is positive. So this is unit trace, and this is the Hermitian, and this should be possible. Every density operator should, or density matrix, should satisfy these three properties. And of course, there is a fourth property, which is trace of rho square has to be less than or equal to 1. It should be less than or equal to 1. And trace of rho square is equal to 1 for pure states. So these are the properties that your density matrix should satisfy. Okay. So in general, So mixed states, mixed states can be expressed as convex combination, not the linear combination, but what we call as convex combination of pure states. So I want you to understand what this means. This means convex combination is another name for, so convex combination is same as what we call as probabilistic mixture. So let us say that let row 1, row 2, etc., some row n be pure states or pure state density operator. So we have n such density operators, row 1, row 2, etc., row n. Then a convex combination of these or a probabilistic mixture of these can be written in the following fashion. That is, let's take Pi into row I. Pi into row I and sum over I is equal to 1 to n. Okay. So this you can call it as sum row. Okay. Now, the Pi such that every Pi is between 0 and 1 and sum over I is equal to 1 to n, Pi has to be equal to 1. These two conditions will tell you that these Pi's are probabilities. Okay. So these two conditions mean that Pi's are probabilities. That this is the property of a probability. Okay. And that is why this is called a probabilistic mixture. So this way of writing is what we call as a convex combination. Convex combination means the coefficient should satisfy these two properties, which is same as saying it is a probabilistic mixture. So if you write something like this, okay, then we call this as a mixture. Okay, so like in the previous discussion, we had So we had the following situation. Let us try to recall our discussions from the last class briefly. Okay, so let's say recall. So we had this discussion that you have some kind of a source which will produce a pair of particles in such a way that your particles are in this kind of a state. Now let me simply write this state to be 0, 0 plus 1, 1. Okay, this is same as up, up plus down, down. So let's say that you have two qubits and two qubits are prepared in this state. And then one qubit is sent this side, and one qubit is sent this side. And this is what you have, A here and B here. And you make measurement, and then after measurement, you collect this articles here, and we are going to have some particles in zero state, some particles in one state, another particle in zero state, another particle in one state, so that if totally n number of particles are there, n by 2 of them are going to be in zero state and n by 2 of them are going to be in one state. So you have a mixture like this, and this mixed state is what we represented by using a density operator or a density matrix, where we said we write down the probability half and then the density matrix corresponding to 0 plus probability half and then the density matrix corresponding to 1. Okay, so this is a mixed state because this is a probabilistic mixture of, so this is a pure state. Okay, this is a pure state. This is a pure state and this is a pure state. But this is a probabilistic mixture of pure states, and hence this one is a mixed state. Okay. So that is what we have seen in the last class, that if you take an entangled state and you try to find out what is going to be the state here, then we are going to have a mixed state. Okay. So this suppose let us now ask a question like this. Suppose let's say that I repeat the same experiment like earlier. So now I have a source. Okay, so this is my source and this is my source. Let's say, but this one is going to have something like this. Let's say 1 by root 2 into 0, 0. Plus 1, 0. Let's say we prepare this in a two-party state like this, and then this one is same experiment is repeated. So you are getting, you have a party A here and party B here, and this guy is going to do experiment on this subject, on this qubit that is comes to A to determine the state. Now notice that this is not an entangled state, because I can write this state as 1 by root 2 into 0 plus 1, okay, multiplied by 0. So this is, so this is an entangled state. Okay, so this is entangled state, whereas this is not an entangled state. This is a separable state. So if it is a separable state, then there is no correlation, right? There are no correlations between these two. So when you do an experiment here and then you collect whatever particle that is coming here, it is coming in this state only. That is 1 by root 2. 0 plus 1. So this is the state in which all the particles are coming here. Okay, there is no mixture here because all the particles which are coming here are in this particular state. Even if you don't, even before you do the measurement, this is the state of the particle. So we can say, even without doing an experiment, we can say what is the state of this particle and what is the state of this particle. So this is separable state. Whereas if you have an entangled state, then we will not be able to say what is the state of this particle. And if you do an experiment to determine them, then we are not able to represent that with any pure state, but we have to consider that to become a mixed state. So this turns out that we seem to be having a very interesting situation where if you say that let's say that the two particle state are the two qubit state is pure state. A two-qubit state also can be mixed state, but let's say that the two-qubit state is a pure state. Then there are two possibilities. One is it can be entangled. Okay, so it can be entangled state, or it can be separable state, like in the two cases that we have discussed. Okay, it can be entangled state and it can be a separable state. Now you ask the question that what is the state of qubit A, if you ask that question. Okay, and this question we seem to get an answer that it is a mixed state. Okay, so on the other hand, if you ask this question, what is the state of qubit A? I mean, I'm asking A, but you could have even asked B. Qubit A, then it turns out that it's a pure state, because this is basically separable state. That means it is a product of two pure states. So the state of A is a pure state. So this is interesting, because now looking at what is the state of A, you will be able to tell whether the two particle state is entangled or not. Okay, so this can be used. This can be used as an indicator to start with, or you can appropriately, or even a measure of entanglement. Okay, now in order to do that, we should understand, so far we have been discussing how to find the state of a subsystem given the state of the full system. We were saying we have to do experiments, then we said it will become a mixed state, then we can write down the mixed state in the following fashion and things like that. But in order to formulate this, we have to develop a mathematical language to do this. Okay. So how do we do this? So the question is how to find the state of qubit A or qubit B, given the state of two qubits A. Okay, so when I say how to find, I'm asking a question, how to find it in theory or mathematically. Okay, so this is what we will develop, so that we have a formalism to work. So when we have this, so to start with, we have a two qubit pure state. So I'm just discussing with pure state, but this procedure is not restrictive of the pure states. Okay, so I don't even have to say pure states. Let's say we have a two qubit state given by a density density operator or a density matrix denoted by row A B. Okay. So row A B. I am going to call this as row A B. Now and note that row AB is a 4x4 complex matrix. Because it is a 2-qubit system. 2-qubit system is 2-qubit state, and hence it is a 4x4 complex matrix. Okay. Now we are going to define. So now let us define a procedure. Okay. So we will define something called partial trace. Define partial trace. Okay, so please understand this carefully. What is this partial trace? Okay, so we understand what a trace is. So let's ask that question. What is the trace? Trace of an operator. How do you do the trace of an operator? So let us say, let A be an operator. Okay. And choose a basis. So let's call that basis as some phi I. Okay. Then trace of A is basically sum over I phi I A. This is called the trace, because when you use phi I and phi I here, if you write A as a matrix in this basis, it is sum over all the diagonal elements. Okay, this is what we call as a trace, right? So sum of the diagonal elements is the trace of a matrix. So since in the same way, this is the trace of an operator. Now, I'm sure you know this, and if you do not know, just try to prove this, that the trace of A is invariant of the choice of basis. It is invariant of the choice of basis. Okay, so I will leave it for you to write down the proof, because if you are changing a basis, then every two bases are related by a unitary matrix, and you can say that you take a new basis with that unitary matrix, and then you can, okay, you write down the proof. It's not very difficult. So if your trace is invariant, for this you write down the. Maybe you have done it already. Okay, so this is what is the trace. Okay, so this part is or the trace of matter. Now, what do you do for a partial trace? Okay, so now partial trace is, that is, you have two systems now. Okay, two systems. So the composite system, is the two systems. A, B is the composite system. Now we are going to talk about the trace of partial trace. That means, suppose I want to get, let's say that we want to know, we want the state of A, system A. So that we will call it as rho A. Now this rho A can be obtained as trace. Now I'm going to trace over B of rho A. So we will say this is trace over subsystem. Trace over subsystem B to get the state of A. Okay, the state of A is this rho A, and we get rho A by tracing over B of rho A. Similarly, we get rho B as trace over A of rho A. Rho B as trace over A of rho A. So this is what we call as trace over subsystem A. Okay, this is how we write it or denote it. Now let us try to understand how to do this in two different notations. First, let us consider. So basically, I'm going to now talk about how to implement partial trace. Partial trace operation. So this is what we will learn it in two different ways. Okay, how to implement partial trace operation. So first, let's consider a pure composite state. Pure composite state, and the pure composite state can be denoted by psi AB. Okay, so let's call this as psi AB. Because it's a pure state, it can be a ket vector. Okay. Now the density operator rho AB is nothing but a projection operator of this psi. Okay, so let me not write AB here, but let's understand rho AB means it is a projection operator like that. Okay. Now, so let us call this as, so this is also of AB, right? Now, suppose I want to get rho A, okay, which, as I wrote earlier, is tracing over B of rho A. Now, trace operation is same. Okay, so choose a basis. Let's call 0B, 1B. 0B, 1B of the Hilbert space HB is the Hilbert space of system B. or a qubit B, then your rho A is going to be 0B of rho AB, 0B plus 1B of rho AB, 1B. Okay, this is only this is a qubit, so there are only two basis states, so two diagonal elements will be there like this. But this is not rho AB is not a 2x2 matrix. Okay, it is a 4x4 matrix. But this operation can be understood in this following way. Suppose if I write this IAB, this rho AB as integral 0B, now psi AB, 0 plus 1B, psi AB, 1B. Okay, so now this is how we write it formally, but then remember this rho A has to be a 2x2 matrix. Okay, so note that rho AB is a 4x4 matrix and rho A or rho B is 2x2 matrix. So when you do a partial trace, you will get a 2x2 matrix. Now let us try to understand this by means of some examples. So let's take an example. Okay. So let's take first example A. Let's say that my psi AB is equal to 0A, 0B. Okay. Which is essentially same as 0A product 0B. Okay. Now if I ask a question, what is the state of A? You know the state because this is the separable state. So that is 0A. State of B also we know. We don't have to do any partial trace. Here we know because it is a separable state. We know the state. But then our partial trace operation should give us this. Okay. So let us go back and implement this one. So let's say that so what is rho AB in this case? Rho AB is equal to 0A, 0B, 0A, 0B. So this is our partial trace. So what will be rho A? Rho A is equal to 0B, 0A, 0B, 0A, 0B, 0B. Okay. So plus 1B, 0A, 0B, 0A, 0B, 1B. Now look at the subscripts. Because this is B, it will only look at what is the state of B in this. So it is 0B and 0B, and hence that is 1. And this is 0B and 0B, and that is why it is 1. 0, 0 is 1. So, and similarly, if you see here, 1B and 0A, okay, so that will become 0. Okay, 1 is becoming 0 is enough, so it is 0 here. Whereas this 0B, 0B is 1, this 0B, 0B is 1. So, as a result, what happens, your rho A is 0A, 0A. So So this is a pure state because this is a projection operator of 0A, 0A. So rho A is basically 0A, 0A, 0A. So the state of A is simply 0A, which is what we know from this particular situation. Okay. Now let us look at second example. Okay, so now let's say my psi AB, is equal to, let's say 1 by root 2, 0, 0, this is AB, plus 1, 0, AB. Okay, so now you have to write down the density matrix. So the density matrix is, but of course you know this is nothing but 1 by root 2 0a plus 1a product 0. So you ask a question, what is the state of A? It is going to be this state, correct? It's a pure state. It's going to be this state. But now suppose you want to ask what will be the partial trace of this one. For that you have to write down rho AB. Rho AB is equal to 1 by 2. Okay. So let me suppress writing this AB. First one is A, second one is B. Let us assume, let us understand it that way. So I write 0, 0 plus 0, 0, 1, 0. Plus 1 0 0 0 plus 1 0 1 0. Okay, the first one is first entry is A followed by so this is the convention. It's easy to remember. Okay. Otherwise, we'll have to write AB. Now, the partial trace is going to be equal to, for each of this term, I have to write 0B. Okay. That is half. So I have 0B. So let me write this 0 for this 0, 0, 0B. Plus 0b 0 0 1 0 0b plus 0b 1 0 0 0 0b plus 0b 1 0 1 0 0. Okay, plus half. Now I have to write four more terms with 1b. It is 1b 0 0 0 0 1b plus 1b 0 0 1 0 1b plus 1b 1 0 0 0 1b plus 1b 10 10. Okay, so this is our partial trace operation. Now, as I told you, this is 0b 0b, that is 1. This is 0 0b, that is 1. Second one is always b. Okay. So this is 1 and this is 1 and 0b 0 is 1, 0 0b is 1, 0b 0 is 1, and 0 0b is 1. And notice this 1b 0 is 0, So every term you can see that it is zero here. So this entire thing, that is one of the term is zero is enough. So I'll just show you, this is zero, this 1b zero is zero, 1b zero is zero. So this is zero, this is zero. So all the second four terms, second terms are zeros, and all the first terms are non-zeros. So what will be our rho a? Our rho a is equal to half into, so you have zero, zero. Okay, so this is zero a, zero a, whatever remaining is only a, plus zero one, that is zero a, one a, plus 1a 0a plus 1a 1. Okay, so this is how it is. Now this is basically, you can write this as you can say that maybe I will call it as plus, where this plus is basically a notation for which we have 1 by root 2 0a plus 1a. Okay, so if you write down plus, then it will become 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. And that is what we have exactly here. Okay, so this is a product state. And we already know here that is what is going to be your state of A, and we have obtained this. Okay, so now that we have understood, this procedure is giving us what is the state. Now we apply this to one of these states. Okay, so now let us take my psi AB to be equal to 1 by root 2. 0, 0 plus 1, 1. Okay, again, same. First one is A, second one is B. Okay, so now we would like to ask what is rho A. So for that, first we will write down rho AB. Okay, so rho AB is equal to 1 by 2, 0, 0, 0, 0 plus 0, 0. 1 1 plus 1 1 0 0 plus 1 1 1 1. Okay, so this is our rho A. Now we want to find out rho A, which is equal to, so let's put this half out. So first we have 0 B 0 0 0, 0, 0, B plus 0, B, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, B plus 0, B, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, B plus 0, B, 1, 1, 1, 1, B. Okay, so this is one term. Then we have plus 1B 0, 0, 0, 0, 1B plus 1B 0, 0, 1, 1, 1B plus 1B 1, 1, 0, 0, 1B plus 1B, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, so this is our partial trace operation. So now you can see 0B, 0, this is 1, and 0, 0B, this is 1, and 0B, 0, this is 1, but 1, 0B, this is 0. So this 1 into 0, this overall term is 0, and 0b1 is 0, and 00b is 1, so this will also be 0, and 0b1 is 0, and 10b is also 0. So these three terms are zeros, only the first term is non-zero. When you come here, this 1B, 0 is 0, and 0, 1B is also 0. 1B, 0 is 0, and 1B, 1 is 1. But anyway, because this is 0, that is 1B, 1 is 1, and 0B, 1 is 0, so this is also 0. And 1B, 1 is 1, and 1, 1B is 1. So only this last term will contribute here, and the first term will contribute in the previous. So as a result, we have this rho A is equal to 1 by 2 into 0A, 0A plus 0B, 0. Okay, so this is a pure state, this is a pure state, but I cannot write this as some pure state, because this is a probabilistic mixture of pure states. Okay, so this is what we have written earlier. This is 1 by 2 0 0 0 0 plus 1 by 2 sorry. This is equal to 1 by 2 0 0 plus 1 by 2 1 1. So that is is our exit state. So we are able to write down. So if you go back, now that we have this technique of finding the state of rho A, the state of A given state of rho AB by doing this partial trace operation, now we can see that if we are finding that state is a mixed state, okay, how do you find out if the state is a mixed state or not? By taking this row square of that one and taking the trace of that. Okay, so then it is very clear whether it is a mixed state or not. If trace of row square is less than 1, then it's a mixed state. Now, if it is a mixed state, then you can go back and say that our original 2-qubit state is an entangled state. Okay, so this is something which we can easily implement. Okay, so now let's try to ask this question in a different way. Okay, we are using this bracket notation because if we have some, you can still use this bracket notation, there is no problem, because we have seen that every mixed state can be written as a convex combination of pure state, and every pure state can be written as a projection operator. Okay, so this is general, quite general. But then suppose if somebody gives you a density matrix, okay, somebody gives you a density matrix, okay, then how do we do that partial tracing? So yeah.
So confusion here. So this rho AB is a 4×4 matrix, and 0A or 0B ket, those are 2×1 matrix. So how are you multiplying them?
I think I made a mistake here. This is 1A and 1B. Is this the confusion?
No, sir. I'm saying that rho AB. It's a 4×4 matrix. Correct. And this 0A or 1A, this is a 2×1 matrix. So the 0A or 1A kit 1, this is a 2×1 matrix. So how are we multiplying them? Like in the previous step, like one in the line, like 1B, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1B. This 0, 0, 0, 0 is 4×4. And 1B is 2×2, and this is 2×1.
So that is what. So we will. So right now in this way that I have done, we are trying to use the Hilbert space bracket notation. Okay. Now let's try to understand how to do this if we are using this matrix notation.
Hello, sir.
Okay. So, yes.
Sir, one doubt, sir. In the previous step, yes, go a little bit back, sir. Little bit scroll up. Yeah, there, sir. If you see that, in the case of row A, half into this 0B, if this ket has two states, so it will be like the element 0B will act on the second state, sir, or why is it equal to 1? I mean, there a little bit of confusion arises. So it's
So basically, so let us just consider one particular term. Let's say I have 0B, let's say 0, 0, and 1, 0, 0. Let's say like this. Okay, consider this one alone. Now this 0, 0 is like so it is like you think that this is one term and this is another term. Okay, so this is nothing but 0B and 0A cross 0B. Okay, so that is what actually this 0A, 0B means, right? So this 0, 0 means this one, right? In the same way, you have 1, 0, this is 1A, 0B. Okay, and so let's say this is what this 1, 0 means, and then I have 0. So when I'm just expanding this one. Now when I say 0B, since this is a tensor product structure like this is there, this 0B will only act on the B space. It will not touch this A space. Similarly, this 0B will act on this B space. Okay, and as such, this 0, 0 inner product is 1 because these are normalized eigenstates, normalized basis states. So 0B, 0B is 1 when it acts on that one. So this becomes 1 and this becomes 1. So what I will have here is only 0A. And here I will have 1A. Okay. So maybe I should write 0A here and 1A. So this is the result of this one.
Now the doubt is, what if it is 0A instead of 0B? Like the first state is 0A means, is it always that the tensor product will act on the second element of the tensor product, or is it like something like that?
Okay, so if it is 0A, so let us now say 0A, suppose you are now tracing over A instead of B. Okay, so you have something like this, right? So 0A. Now this 0 has to be looked at with the first element, because this is the A-th element and this is B-th element. First one is A, second one is B. That is our convention. So 0A, 0A is again 1. But here, 1A, 0A becomes 0. Okay, if you are doing a partial trace over B, okay, this becomes 0. So this matrix, so this term of partial tracing will become 0 if you are tracing over A. Whereas if you are tracing over B, this will give you 0A, 1A.
Sir, if you can kindly expand the second term, that 1, 0 and 0A, it would be great, sir. How it became 0? I think the doubt will be solved. If you can expand that 1, 0 and 0A, yeah.
Okay, so this is basically, you have 0A and 0A product 0B. Correct?
Yes.
So that is the first term. And the second term is 1A product 0B, 0A.
Yes.
So this 0A will combine with only 1A. This 0A will combine with 0A.
Yes.
A will combine with A only. But 1 and 0 are two orthogonal states. So 1A, 0A is 0. So this part will be 0. And this part is 1. But anyway, 1 into 0 is 0. So this whole term will give you 0.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, Shobhik here.
Yeah.
Sir, so the basic commutative property of normal product is not followed.
What is that?
Sir, if like A into B plus C is AB plus AC, we won't get that here in tensor product.
No, because see, the point is that you still get that. Oh, okay. It's not like that in the inner product. You are right.
Yes, like in inner for this inner product, for this tensor product, if commutative rules will follow, then we would get A 0A 0A into 0A 0B. Then
yeah, but what I'm trying to say is that this 0A 0B, this is meaningless.
Okay, not
has no meaning. Because these are two different systems, no?
Okay.
See, in general, this in general, you may say that A may be a qubit, okay, and B can be a qutrit, for example. We are taking two qubits, but you could have also taken this as a two-dimensional vector and this as a three-dimensional vector.
Okay.
Then this makes no sense, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That is why you should not see that as a distributive property in the inner product like that. Because these are two distinct systems.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I mean, now it's clear.
Okay, any other question? Just a minute. Okay, so now let's try to understand how do we use, well, let's try to develop this matrix notation. Okay, so for that, first what we will do is we will try to develop a matrix notation for a qubit. So first, let's take a qubit state. So we say 0. Okay, so this 0 we will represent as 1, 0. And 1 we will represent as 0, 1. So this is the starting point. We represent this as 0, 1, 1, 0. Now corresponding to this 0, okay, now we saw this is the basis. Of course, this is a basis for a two-dimensional complex Hilbert space. Okay, this is, you multiply this with one complex number and this with another complex number, then you will get a general complex number, correct? So you can say that a general qubit state as we have written earlier, can be written as, we always write it as some kind of a theta phi, and then that is equal to cos theta by 2 into 1, 0 plus sine theta by 2 e to the power I phi 0, 1, which is basically cos theta by 2 into cos theta by 2 sine theta by 2 into e to the I phi as a column. So this is the most general qubit pure state in terms of the matrix notation. Now we can ask a question that suppose we know this qubit, and then we will talk about two qubit case. Okay, so two qubits. So whenever you have two qubits, then we have 0 0 0 1 1 0 1 1. So this is the basis. Okay, this is generally called the computational basis. Computational basis. Sometimes I may also represent this one as this can also be represented equivalently as 0 1 2 3. Okay, the four dimensional representation, I mean the four dimensional space, so we'll have four basis vectors. Now the connection between this 0 1 2 3 and 0 0 0 1 1 0 1 1 is that this one will be a binary representation of this. Okay, for example 0 0 is a binary representation of this, 0 1 is a binary representation of this, 1 0 is a binary representation of this, 1 1 is a binary representation of this. Correct? This is easy to understand, right? 1 1 is 1 into 2 power 0 plus 1 into 2 power 1. That will give you 3. This is the representation which we will use even if you go to more number of qubits. For example, n qubits, you may have 0 to 2 to the power n minus 1. And then each one of its binary representation will be the corresponding n qubit state. Okay, so this is first thing that we should understand, that you can have two ways of writing the basics, either 0 1 2 3 or in terms of its binary representation, where we will know what is the state of each qubit if you write them in the binary representation. Okay, so this is first level. Second level is this 0 0 is basically 0 product 0. Okay. Similarly, 0 1 is 0 product 1. Okay. Now I'm going to tell you how to write this matrix. This is a matrix where you have 1 0, a tensor product of this with 1 0. So how do we do this? What you are going to do is that you take this element and multiply with this vector. Okay, take this element and multiply with this vector. That is 1 multiplied with 1 0 is 1 0. Then 0 multiplied with 1 0 is 0 0. Okay. That is what this is. So this is basically 1 into 1 0, 0 into 1 0. That is what this is. So this 1 is multiplied by this vector, and then 0 is also multiplied by this vector, and write one after the other. Okay. So now what will be 0 1? 0 1 is equal to 0 product 1. That is nothing but 1 0 product 0 1. What will that be equal to? 0 1 0 0. In the same way, your 1 0 vector is going to be equal to 1 product 0, that is equal to 0 1 product 1 0, which is equal to 0 0 1 0. On the other hand, 1 1 is equal to 1 product 1, that is equal to 0, 1, product 0, 1, that is equal to 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, so you know this is the matrix representation of a 2-qubit states. Now we can ask a question, how do I write the density operators? Okay, so first let us ask density matrices of a qubit. Density matrices of a qubit. We know that this 0 is equal to 1, 0. Now we ask what is 0, 0. So 0, 0 is basically 1, 0 product 1, 0. This is the Bra vector. Bra vector is a row with complex conjugate. Now this is also same. You take 1 and multiply this 1, 0 and then take 0 and multiply with 1, 0. So this is a matrix, a 2 by 2 matrix. Now what will be 1, 1? 1, 1 is 0, 1 product 0, 1. So that is 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay. So these two are projection matrices. Okay. So I will leave it as an exercise for you to find out what is plus, plus, where this plus is 1 by root 2, 0 plus 1. So in terms of a matrix, it is 1, 1. Okay. So you write down a unit, a matrix corresponding to this one. Okay, so this is about the, how do we write the density matrix for a qubit. Now suppose if you have a 2-qubit matrices. Okay, 2-qubit matrices. So now let us try to write down, so write the matrix. Write the matrix for, let's say, your psi is equal to 1 by root 2, 0, 0, plus 1, 1. Okay. So basically, what is 0, 0? We have already seen here. 0, 0 is 1, 0, 0, 0. 1, 1 is 0, 0, 0, 1. So this is going to be equal to 1 by root 2 into 1, 0, 0, 1. This is the matrix. So what will be the density matrices corresponding to that? That is equal to psi, psi, that is equal to 1 by 2. So you have 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1. So that is equal to 1, 0, 0, 1, then 0 multiplied by this, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. Okay, so this is the density matrix corresponding to this particular. Okay, so this is how we write down the matrices. Now we would like to develop, okay, so we would like to develop a notation. After we got an idea of how to write down these matrices, now let's try to understand. So in order to develop a notation for a notation for partial trace. Consider your row AB, maybe row A product row B. That means it is a product state, not an entangling state. Okay. Now, this is a 4x4 matrix and these are 2x2 matrices. Okay. So let us now say that, okay, we have to carefully design this notation. So let us say that, maybe I will write this. Okay, I think it is better to write like this. So this is equal to, so let's write row A as row 0, 0, row 0, 1, row 1, 0, row 1, 1. Okay, I can write like this. Okay, now let us write row B as, let me simply say row tilde 0, 0, row tilde 0, 1, row tilde 1, 0, row tilde 1, 1. Let us write it like this. Then we ask our row AB to be row A product row B, which is equal to row 0, 0, row 0, 1, row 1, 0, row 1, 1, product row tilde 0, 0, row tilde 0, 1, row tilde 1, 0, row tilde 1. Now this one I am going to now multiply. That is, first take row 0, 0 and multiply with this one. That is, row 0, 0, row 0, 0 tilde, row 0, 0, row tilde 0, 1, row 0, 0, row tilde 1, 0, row 0, 0, row tilde 1, 1. So this is, then I have row 0, 1, row 0, 0 tilde, row 0, 1, row 0, 1 tilde, row 0, 1, row 1, 0 tilde, row 1, row 0, 1, row 1, 1. So that is the second block. Then I have row 1, 0, row 0, 0 tilde, row 1, 0, row 0, 1 tilde, row 1, 0, row 1, 0 tilde, row 1, 0, and row 1, 1 tilde. And final block is row 1, 1, row 0, 0 tilde, row 1, 1, row 0, 1 tilde, row 1, 1, row 1, 0 tilde, row 1, 1, row 1, 1. So this will be my, so it is easy to just think this in terms of four blocks. So it is easy to remember this as four blocks. Okay. Now, what is basically, when you are taking a partial trace, okay, so the meaning of partial trace over A of row AB, or trace over B for that matter of row AB, is equal to row A, right? That is equal to, when you are tracing this one, this is basically what? Your row A and B is traced over. So when you trace over B, what will happen? You will have this row A is multiplied by what? Row 0, 0 tilde plus row 1, 1 tilde. Because row B is traced over. In the same way, when you are taking row B, that is equal to trace over A of row AB, then you are going to have row 0, 0 plus row 1, 1 multiplied by this row B. Okay. So, we are now going to ask how we are going to get these results from here. Okay. Now, to get row A, what you are going to do is row 0, 0. Okay. So, row A is you must get. So, to get this one, you take this block. Okay, so let's imagine this row AB to be kind of a block like this. Okay, so there is a block here, and there is a block here, there is a block here, and there is a block here. Okay, now to get row A, which is equal to trace over row AB, okay, now trace over B of row AB. Now, what you have to do is you take the trace of this block. Okay, what is the trace of that block? Row 0, 0 into row 0, 0 tilde plus row 1, 1 tilde. Okay, so that will be, okay, so let's say this, let me call this as block 1 or block 0, 0, block 0, 1, and block 1, 0, and block 1, 1. Let's call it that way. This is basically, you are going to have trace of block 0, 0, trace of block 0, 1, trace of block 1, 0, and trace of block 1, 1. Okay, that will be your row A. Okay, what will be your row B? Row B is trace over A of row AB. This is nothing but B 0 0 plus B 1 1. That means it is a block wise trace. Okay, B 0 0 plus B 1 1 will be equal to, it's a 2 by 2 matrix. So B 0 0 plus B 1 1 is a trace block. This is block wise trace and this is trace of the blocks. So that is how you get this one. So if you look at this, suppose if I take trace of block 1, then, so look at this one. If I take trace of block 1, this is row 0, 0 into row 0, 0 tilde plus row 1, 1 tilde. Similarly, row 0, 0 tilde, row 1, 1 tilde plus row 1, 1 tilde into row 0, 1. So, if you do blockwise trace, you will see that this will come out as common. And then row 0, 0, row 0, 1, row 1, 0, row 1, 1 will remain in this one. Now, suppose you take this block, okay, you take this block and then add it to this block. Then what happens? Row 0, 0 plus row 1, 1 into row 0 tilde, row 0, 0 plus row 1, 1 into row 0, 1 tilde. So, you will get row 0, 0, row 1, 1 common and then you will get this row. So, now we have abstracted it out. Now we don't require to remember this 0, 0, tilde and all these things. Whenever you have a 4x4 matrix. Okay, so now let's try to practice this. So consider this matrix. So given matrix, given state, is, let us say, row AB is equal to 1/2 × 1 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 1 0 0 1. Now tell me, what is your row A? Suppose if I ask that question, so what you have to do immediately is you divide this into blocks. So your row A, so row A is what? Block wise trace. Okay, so now you take a trace of this block, that is 1, trace of this block, that is 0, trace of this block, that is 0, trace of this block, that is 1. Because there is a half here. Okay, and similarly, suppose if I ask what is row B, then you take this block and then add to this block, that is 1 0 0 0 plus 0 0 0 1, that is also 1 0 0 1. So this is how you have to implement a partial trace operation. Okay, a partial trace operation has to be implemented in this fashion. Okay, in other words, you can always so this is, if you understand this, then given any matrix, we will be able to write down this partial trace operation. Now when we are doing a partial trace operation, then we will not consider tracing. It's not tracing with a 2-qubit basis, but it's only tracing with a partial basis. Okay, so now we can ask a question that how do we represent? Okay, so the question is how to represent. How to represent this thing, that is, suppose 0B and let's say 0A, 0B. Okay, so 0A, 0B. What are we saying? We are saying this one will be equal to 0A. Okay, now what does this mean? This means in matrix notation, represent this in matrix notation. I think this is the question which you people were asking. Okay. Now let's say that this 0A is nothing but it is 1, 0. And 0A, 0B is nothing but 1, 0, 0, 0. Okay, 1, 0, 0, 0. Okay, so this I should get it as 1, 0. 1, 0 of A. So how do we get this? This is the question. Now let's try to understand that. So I'm just representing this one in this way, but we know that this is 1, 0. Okay, so let us write this is of B. And what is this one? This one is 1, 0 of A multiplied by 1, 0 of B. Okay, and this B should only act on this one. Okay, or in other words, what this means is that this is equal to 10B into 1A of 10B and 0A of 1, 0, p. Correct? That is how it is written in this fashion, right? Now this 1b will act on each one of these, leaving this 1a and 1b. This 1b will act on each one of this. Okay. In other words, if you are trying to look at it, so it's not very easy to look at it in this way. But suppose if I write it as a vector, for example, as a matrix, so your 0a, 0b, 0a, 0b, this as a matrix is equal to 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So this is your matrix. Okay. Now you know that if you are trying to take trace over whether A or B, it is going to be 1000 is going to be your this thing. Correct? So now we are going to say that. So what does this mean? That means your 0B, 0A, 0B, 0A, 0B, 0B. What does that mean? That means so you are going to have so you want to get row A. Row A is blockwise trace, right? So that is blockwise trace. That means you must consider this. So you are getting this because you are taking your product such that this block is that of B. So you have to take a blockwise trace. Okay, so that means you must. So it is like you have your 1 0, and this one is like a 4x4 blocks, and then you have this 1 0. That means this 1 0 0 1 is trying to allow you to take this blockwise trace. Okay, so this is the meaning of that. And essentially, what I'm trying to say is that you must understand that the tensor product structure is such that, just like here we have seen, that it is going to be this. So this you can write it in the following fashion, right? So this one could have been written in the following fashion. That is row 0, 0 into row B. So this is a block. Row 0, 1 into row B. This is a block. And row 1, 0 into row B. This is a block. Row 1, 1 into row B. This is a block. Now, when you are taking a partial trace over B, that means you are taking trace over B. So that means you take trace over row B only. So that means you are going to take blockwise trace, because row B has to be traced everywhere, right? So that is why you have to take it as a blockwise trace. Now, if you are taking trace over A, now A is there, so row B is common, so you have to take row 0, 0 plus row 1, 1, and row B is common, and hence you have to take a trace of these blocks. Okay, so that is another way in which you, this is more general way, because if you have, you can always write down a matrix given a state. So once you write down the matrix, taking the partial trace is trivial in this fashion. So this is another way. So we have discussed two ways. One is by using this sket notation, And then second one is by just developing a method how to take the partial trace of a given matrix. So any questions at this point?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, can you please explain that second last step?
Which is the second last step?
Sir, before that, just one step before that.
This 0A, 0B, this one.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so what I'm trying to say is that you want to take trace over A of this quantity, okay? The trace over B of this quantity, then you take trace of this, okay? That is one, and then all others are zero, correct? On the other hand, if you want to take trace over A of this quantity, the same quantity, then you take this block and then add to this block, which is once again 1001. Okay, so 1000. So 1000 is basically 0A, 0A as 00. Okay, so that means the state is 0. That is what we know. 0A, 0B, the state of A is 0 and state of B is 0B. Okay, that is what we are getting by taking the partial trace. Okay, I mean, if you don't understand this language, it doesn't matter, so don't worry. But right now, I want you to understand that the summary of taking a partial trace is that whenever you have row AB, somebody gives you a 4x4 matrix. Okay, so first divide that into blocks of 2x2 matrices. You call this block as B00. You call this block as B01. You call this block as B10. Call this block as B11. Okay, where this B00 is also a 2x2 matrix. Okay, so maybe I will call it as B0000, B0001, B0010, and B0011. Okay, 00 is common. Please remember that 00 is associated with the block indices, whereas these are indices of the this one. So in the same way, what will be your B01? B01 will be equal to B0100, B0101, B0110, and B0111. So 01 is the block index, and 00011 is like this. So in general, you can say that your row. So now what I'm trying to say is that if you are trying to take trace over trace over B of AB, that means you are going to write this as trace over B00. Okay, trace over B00, trace over B01, trace over B10, and trace over B11. So sir, take the trace. Yes.
Here is just that you have to add B00 and B11. It's actually trace over A is only this much. I think.
No, trace over A is you have to add. Okay, so this is row A. This is row A, and row B is trace over A of row AB. That is simply B00 plus B11.
Sir, I think the opposite way around. Is it not? Little bit, I was confused maybe.
No. I think it's easy to remember. That's why I said here, I wrote it like this. Trace over B means you have to trace over row B. That means every block wise you have to trace over B, right? So that is what is your trace over B. That will give you row A. Okay, so what I've written is correct. So trace over B is B00 plus B11.
Yes sir. I mean, I just altered it. Sorry.
So this is the summary. This is how you have to find out this one.
One small thing, sir.
Yeah.
Little bit scroll up, sir. Little bit. Yeah. This one here. Yes, sir. Your how to represent this in matrix notation, sir. Can you give us, can you similarly, an equivalency of that in that, what is it called as bracket notation, sir, here itself, so that it will be like easy for comparing these two notations. This part along with this bracket notation of this, how to represent this 0B, 0A, 0B in bracket notation. So it will be easy to compare and then.
Bracket notation is same, that is you get 0A and then product 0B. So that is your bracket notation. So then this 0B, A will combine only with 0B to give you simply 0A. Right. So that is, so the product structure is what we are considering this to be, this one.
Yes, this is what I was asking. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So in matrix notation, the same thing there we are talking about. We have to take the dot product of 0B and 0B and then multiply with 0A.
Yeah.
You've done this now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So, so essentially this, please remember that this particular concept of taking partial trace is very important, because after some time we will use this, especially given a composite 4x4 matrix of two qubit states, or any, for that matter, any composite state, then how to represent this in terms of different states. For example, let's say that you have just to take this further. So let's say that you have consider a qubit qutrit system. Okay, suppose you take a qubit qutrit system. Qubit is a two-dimensional system and qutrit is a three-dimensional system. So your row is a six by six matrix. Okay, so row is a 6x6 matrix. So row AB is a 6x6 matrix. Now you have to consider, so row AB, when you have 6x6 matrix, how do we distinguish this? 6x6 matrix will be now considered as two blocks. Okay, so this B00, B01, B10, B11. Now each, so this Bij is a 3x3 matrix, because row B is a 3x3 matrix. Okay, so it's a 3x3 matrix. Now suppose if I take trace over B of row AB, what should I get? I should get the state of A. State of A has to be 2x2 matrix. So that means if I take trace of B00, I will get one number. And trace of B11, I will get one number, this one number. So I will get a 2x2 matrix, right? So trace of B00, trace of B101, and trace of B10, and trace of B11. So it is easy to understand if we have different dimensions, then this is 2x2 matrix, and this has to be 2x2 matrix. Okay. Now, on the other hand, if you say that you want to find out trace over A, of row AB. Now, if you are tracing over here, I should get the state of B. No, state of B has to be 3x3 matrix because it's a three-dimensional space. So that is what you will get when you take B00 plus B11. This is a 3x3 matrix. Okay, so this is how we will consider. Okay, A and B. Okay, suppose if you consider the system, that is, let's say A is 3-dimension and B is 2-dimension. Okay, then this is 3x2 system. 3x2. Then your row AB has to be now understood as made up of kind of a 3x3. This will be a 2x2 system. This will be 2x2. This will be 2x2. This will be 2x2. So these are 2x2 matrices. 2x2 matrices. Now, when you want to trace over B of row AB, then what happens? Each block you have to take trace over B. Then you will get row A. That will be a 3x3 matrix. Okay. Now, if you want to take trace over A of row AB, then what will happen? You will take trace of this blockwise trace. That is, this block plus this block plus this block. That will be a 2x2 matrix. Okay. So that is the way that we deal with the we calculate these partial traces. Okay. So I hope it is clear and how to do this partial trace operation. And once this is clear, then let me just define one important concept or a property. So now we know how to do this. So now we are going to try. So we have seen that if you have a pure entangled state, when you take a partial trace and find out the state of subsystem, if that subsystem is a mixed state, then the two-qubit state or the composite state is entangled. Okay, so that is what we have established. Now we are going to define some kind of a measure of the entanglement. So what we do is that suppose if a pure entangled state. Pure entangled state is given. A from psi AB. Then we have our row AB to be equal to psi AB. Psi AB. So this is our density matrix. And if you consider row A, which is equal to trace over B of row AB, is mixed. Okay. Now we can ask a question that we can define something called. So you try to write down minus trace of row A logarithm of row A. Row A is an operator. Logarithm of row A is another operator, which is basically a nonlinear operator. So when you define this one, so we define this as S. Okay. So if you define this, okay, and this is called von Neumann entropy. on Neumann entropy. Now practically, this is nothing but, so S can be written as minus, okay, so this one has to be careful about this log. I will tell you what this log is. This can be written as minus sum over lambda I into log lambda I and sum over I, where this lambda I are eigenvalues of rho A. Okay, this rho A is called reduced density operator, or in probability language we call this as marginal density. That means you take a partial trace, you get marginal density. Okay, so you can see that the marginal density, eigenvalues of marginal density can be used to calculate this. Now this log, this is logarithm to the base 2. As in information theory, it is always, there are two bits, so the logarithms are always defined not to the base e but to the base 2. Now let us look at when we consider this rho A, that is for psi AB is equal to 1 by root 2 0 0 plus 1 1, and we had taken this, we got this rho A to be equal to 1 by 2 1 0 0 1. Okay, so that means what? You have two eigenvalues, lambda 1 is equal to half, lambda 2 is also equal to half. So then we try to calculate von Neumann entropy, minus half log half minus half log half. Log is to the base 2. So this will be actually equal to 1. So that means this von Neumann entropy is 1. Okay, and this, the maximum value this S can take is only 1. Okay, so S actually, this S will lie between 0 and 1, and S equal to 0 implies the state, the composite pure state is separable, it means not entangled. Okay, and S equal to non-zero implies the composite state is entangled, and S is equal to 1 implies the composite state is what is called maximally entangled. So in some sense, the von Neumann entropy value is going to tell you a measure of entanglement. If you calculate S and you find two states, one for one state S is more than the other, we can say that the one with higher value of S is more entangled, and S equal to 1 corresponds to maximally entangled state. And so if rho AB is maximally entangled, then rho A is maximally mixed. So for a marginal density, you can say that the von Neumann entropy can be used as a measure of mixedness. That means how mixed it is. If S is equal to 1, means that marginal density is maximally mixed. That means qubit state is maximally mixed. On the other hand, the composite state is maximally entangled. So maximum entanglement of the composite state means that maximal mixing of the corresponding subsystem state. So this is the feature that comes out of this definition of von Neumann entropy. Okay. So we have discussed mainly how to mathematically represent this particular case where how to mathematically calculate something that requires what is called finding the state of subsystem given the state of the composite system. So that is what we have discussed, and I think the this is an important thing because considering the subsystems is something that we always come to this, and we will try to understand another operation. For example, one of the issue here is that as I told you that this particular von Neumann entropy as a measure of entanglement is valid only for pure states. Okay, so I think if a pure entangled state is given, okay, this has to be underlined. Suppose if the composite state is a mixed state, then partial trace of a mixed state will always be a mixed state. So you cannot recognize whether a state is entangled or not by this criteria if you have a pure, if you have a composite state itself to be a mixed state. So that is very important to understand how to say whether a state is entangled or not, even if the state is mixed to start with. So we will try to develop a method which is not based on partial trace, but it is based on something called partial transpose, and that for a limited systems, that is a very nice criteria which can be used to tell whether a given state is entangled or not. Okay. So maybe I will stop here. We can ask if you have questions.
Thank you, sir. So this you written eigenvalues of P A or O A. How do you calculate that one? Like P A is what? Like how do you calculate P A?
No, there is no P I, right? There you have rho A. You will get a 2x2 matrix, and you have to find out eigenvalues.
Rho, of that rho A is same as that partial
trace over B. Yeah, of rho A.
We'll never get this eigenvalues negative. It will always be positive.
Yes, because it's a density matrix, so it has to be positive. So eigenvalues are always positive. They are either zero or positive.
Okay, it cannot be complex also.
No, it is a Hermitian. Okay. They cannot be complex.
Okay, sir. So one more thing. So this rho A that we are calculating, rho A and rho B. We can calculate it for any pure state. Like,
you can calculate for a pure state or even a mixed state. There is no problem because we have seen any given 4x4 matrix, we know how to calculate rho A or rho B.
Yes, yes, sir. Is it possible? I'm asking this one. Like rho A and rho B, we can calculate. Can we write rho AB as multiplication of rho A and rho B?
No, that's not possible because if that is the whole point, if you have a entanglement, then when you do this partial tracing, you lose that, no? So you cannot get it back. So that is irreversibly lost. By definition, an entangled state is not a product state.
Okay, okay. Like if it is not entangled, then you can write?
Then you can write. If it is not entangled, then you can write.
Rho A equal to rho A into rho A.
Yes, yes. Then you can write.
Okay, sir. And this we have written is equal to the von Neumann entropy, that rho A log of rho A this row A, suppose it is a, right now it is a 2 into 2 matrix.
Mm.
So the logarithm is with respect to base 2. So it will be always base 2 or it can be different if row A is different.
In this field, we are always using it to the base 2.
Whether row A is like 3 into 3 matrix, 2 into 2 matrix.
Yes. Whatever it is, it's always to the base 2.
Okay, sir. And this, we are writing this row A into log of row A. Mm-hmm. If we want to directly calculate it, it is like expanding row A in terms of like the we have to expand it, then we have to multiply, then we have to find the stress.
Correct.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So,
yeah.
So actually, this entropy is defined using the trace of rho A and log of rho A. If we ignore the eigenvalue parts.
Yeah, trace of rho A, log rho A. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So the entropy is for the whole system, or the whole composite system, or the rho A, or the A system.
The von Neumann entropy is defined for subsystems density matrix. Okay, but that can give that is used as a measure of the entanglement of composite system.
Okay, sir. So seeing the entropy of a subsystem, we can determine exactly. If the upper exactly. system.
Yeah. This is the entropy of a subsystem, and that gives us a measure of the entanglement of the composite system.
Okay, sir. And what if we use the row B instead of row A?
Yeah, that's a good question. So you can actually use any of them. It doesn't matter.
So we'll get the same conclusion about the upper composite system.
Yeah.
So log to the base 2 is used also for Shannon entropy, no?
Correct.
Log Shannon. So, yeah. What is the related, like von Neumann entropy and Shannon entropy are they related? Like if we use k equal to 1 and log to the base 2, then we get Shannon entropy. I did the reading thermodynamics.
Correct.
So, here.
So, the Shannon theory is for the classical information. Whether it is classical information or quantum information, you always use log to the base 2.
Okay, sir. And so for von Neumann entropy, it is similar to the Gibbs entropy, entropy relation. Like if we use k equal to 1 and log to the base 2, then in place of the Boltzmann constant, we use 1.
Yeah.
To the base ln, we use log to the base 2, then it's similar to the Gibbs entropy relation.
Correct. So that's why I was telling that a mixed state is like an ensemble, so it is actually same that Gibbs entropy and this Shannon entropy and von Neumann entropy, they all share same concept. So the only thing is what those PIs mean is different in different contexts. That's all. But it is essentially the concept of that ensemble that is there in all cases.
Eigenvalues take the place of probabilities.
Correct. Yes.
So there's a relation between eigenvalues and probabilities.
Yeah. So if you have a density matrices, the eigenvalues of density matrices can correspond to the probabilities of probabilities corresponding to different pure states into which you can decompose this.
Okay, sir. And so I came from an interview.
Ah, so what happened? How was that?
So I couldn't answer one question, but the rest of the question I could answer. They have asked me to plot sine x by x, which I plotted last time. So they said that what happens at x equal to 0, I said it's a discontinuous. I said L Hospital's rule I have taken.
Hmm.
It approaches value 1. Hmm. They asked me to draw the derivative of sine x by x at x equal to 0. That I couldn't draw.
Oh, okay.
And they have asked me to a bus stop. I'm standing at a bus stop.
Hmm.
And a bus comes every 10 minutes.
Hmm.
So what is the probability that I will get a bus with a fixed amount of time? And like, what is the probability distribution? Like, what is the mean value? All this and electrodynamics, they have asked me to, like, why do you need potentials? So I answered that the potentials are scalars, like electric potential is a scalar quantity, so it's easy to work with. And like potential, we have different choices, like gauge transfer, gauge choices. So you can use with the simplest one, work with the simplest one. They have, I said that we get potentials because electric field is a conservative field. They have asked that, what is a conservative field? So I said it's the work done is path independent. So, and if we go around a closed loop, then the work done is zero. So they have said the electric field, if we talk about electrodynamics, then is it electric field is like conservative field? I said it depends on the B field, like it depends on the magnetic field. Curl of E equals minus dou B dou T. So, so it lasted around 20 minutes. So I'm not sure like they are interested to ask me more questions or not.
Okay, anyway, you have done your job. Let us see what will happen.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, you talked about that von Neumann entropy about a single, about a subsystem. What does that entropy means in the case of a qubit?
See, every time when we use this word entropy, it only means that there is a there is a lack of information or an ignorance. In statistical mechanics also, we do not know the microstates properly, so we use entropy so that we can quantify the amount of ignorance that we have about the system. In the same way, here also, when you say that your system is entangled in an entangled state, we have no idea about the state of the subsystem. So there is some amount of ignorance about the state of the subsystem. So we are only quantifying that ignorance by defining appropriate terms. Since always entropy quantifies ignorance, we call this also entropy.
So sir, if 50% chance for each of the state, then the entropy is maximum.
Exactly. Okay. See, when you say 50%, that means you don't know. That's what it means. Always I told you that postulate of equal a priori probabilities means I don't know anything. If any information, then you should be able to assign a better probability than equal probability.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir?
Yeah.
Is partial trace a way to represent linear systems?
Partial trace are? What?
Are a way to represent these individual systems?
Yeah. So partial trace is a mathematical tool by which you can derive the state of individual system given the state of composite system.
Suppose we have a composite system that is entangled, and we can find rho A, rho B again from composite system, right?
If you know the composite system, you can find rho A, rho B.
Like for entangled system, if I say maximally entangled system is there, and we found the rho AB for that, and from rho AB we can calculate rho A and rho B separately.
Okay.
Now when we have found this rho A and rho B, can we say that okay, we know about system A and system B, state of system A, system B?
Yeah, we know that state only as a mixed state, right? So mixed state comes with mixed state means we only know it with some ignorance.
Okay.
Because mixed state is just a probabilistic mixture, right? So we do not know.
Okay, sir.
So that much ignorance we have to put up with. It is like saying we know the ensemble.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Understood, sir.
any other question?
Excuse me, sir. Sir, why this von Neumann entropy is used as a measure of the entanglement?
Okay. So I do not know what exactly you have in mind when you ask this question, why? But I am tempted to ask. I am tempted to ask the question, why not? But I think if you are asking, because there is a direct relation between the amount of entanglement between two systems and the amount of ignorance that is there in the subsystem's state. So in order to, and this is a very direct correlation as far as pure states are concerned. Since for pure states this correspondence is there, then we can use this as a measure of entanglement. That means if you consider subsystem state, if it is more mixed, then the composite state is more entangled. If this is maximally mixed, then that is maximally entangled. So such a one-to-one, what we call as a monotonous relation is there. Monotonic relation is there between these two. And hence, an appropriately defined entropy will be a good measure of the entanglement of the composite system. Or do you have something else in mind?
Sir, I mean, I am thinking like, you were saying that if the if the individual systems A and B, can we say that whether they are more mixed or less mixed? I mean, can we have these kind of notions?
Yes, more mixed or less mixed, we can have this notion in the sense that. See, basically, as I told you, that a mixed state can be written as a decomposition of some pure states. Okay, convex combination of pure states or a probabilistic mixture of pure states. Suppose, let us say that I have a pure state whose probability is 0.9 and they have another pure state whose probability is 0.1. Let's say I have 0.9. 0, 0 and 0.111. Suppose if I have that kind of a pure state or a mixed state, okay, so what I'm trying to say is that imagine I have two mixed states. One mixed state is rho 1 that is equal to 0.900 plus 0.111. Okay. This is a mixed state, but this is a probabilistic mixture of two states. On the other hand, let's say I have rho 2, which is half 0, 0 plus half 1, 1. So this is also a mixed state, but which one is more mixed? Because here I know this is more close to pure state, right? If this is 1 and this is 0, that means it is a pure state. So this is not pure state, but the probabilities are so high, that means more or less this is close to 0, whereas this is equidistant from 0 and 1. Or in other words, if you imagine that geometrically you say that this is 0 and this is 1, okay, so now you can have a mixed state like this, which is close to 0, and you can have a mixed state like this, which is equidistant from this. So this particular state is more mixed because we have less information about that. Whereas this one is not, we have information that we know that it is very close to 0. That means there is a high probability for it to be 0 and some less probability for it to be 1. Nevertheless, it is mixed, but there is a hierarchy in terms of mixture. So this is more mixed, or this is maximally mixed compared to any other state.
So, sir, writing this mixed state as a convex combination of pure states, so that is not unique, right?
Yeah,
I can
correct.
Say in my basis. So, I mean, this should be relative to a basis.
Correct. So that is not unique. So that is a very good point, and this is very important. we will spend a little more time on this. So this is not unique, but what are you expecting that it is not unique means what? What is the?
I am trying to say that this mixedness that you defined, I mean that you just defined, that this the fast state, which is a mixture of 0, 0 and 1, 1 with probability 0.9 and 0.1, is more close to. That should be thought as more close to the state zero, pure state zero.
Correct.
Yeah. So, therefore, I'm thinking that this mixedness or pureness that you are defining, that should be relative to a set of bases that you are using.
Correct.
Otherwise, that 0.9 and 0.1 can be changed. If I change my basis,
correct.
Then the things will be different.
Correct. So, yeah, it's a very nice point. So the point, so your question is really valid. If you change a basis, the 0.9 and 0.1 will change. But what I'm trying to say is, when we are defining finally some quantity to represent a measure, we are always trying to define that using trace operations, and trace doesn't depend on the choice of basis. Okay, so the final quantity that you are defining is an independent quantity of whatever basis that you choose. Okay, so that way, your von Neumann entropy doesn't depend on the choice of the basis. But you want to write down the density matrix, then of course it depends on which pure states you are choosing, and that's not unique. I'm only giving this 0.9, 0.1 as an example, because you said why there should be difference in terms of mixing. I'm giving one example, and if this 0.9, 0.1 in one basis and half in the same basis are two different mixed states with the variation in mixing character.
Yes, sir. So this von Neumann entropy will not change, because that is defined in terms of the trace. So that will not change by changing the basis. Then therefore, I mean, I am asking that why then this von Neumann entropy should be taken as a measure of the mixture kind of thing. I mean,
yeah. So what I'm trying to say is that if your density matrix is defined as a mixed state with respect to one decomposition, that mixture somehow will remain. That suppose, let's say, that mixedness is related to the lack of information. Now, by choosing another basis, we cannot get more information. That's what I am trying to say. If there is certain amount of information that is missing, which is what is given in terms of the mixture, and that missing information cannot be obtained by simply changing the basis. So that will show up in some other form, that's all. And that is the reason why we have to define quantities such that they don't depend on the basis. Physically, if there is a missing information, that missing information cannot be obtained by just changing the basis, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah.
So that mixture, mixedness is essentially quantifying the missing information or our ignorance about the system.
Yes, sir. Therefore, I mean that can be, a other function, so that it will not depend upon the basis. I mean, other monotonic function, not necessarily.
But
that,
here, von Neumann entropy also doesn't depend on the basis, right? If you are asking a question, are there other measures? Yes, there are many other measures to talk about entanglement. So that the reason that there are many measures is one reason, indication that there are issues with each one of the measures that we define. Okay, as we go along, we will also talk about other measures of entanglement and see why other methods are defined at all for the first place. But von Neumann entropy is a measure of entanglement as far as pure composite states are concerned. If the composite state is mixed, then this will not be a measure of entanglement. It's not also a measure for all states. It's only a measure for pure states. Because pure states, when you do a partial trace, you will get a mixed state. And the amount of mixing in the mixed state is directly proportional to the amount of entanglement in the pure state. So because of this correspondence, for pure entangled states, Von-Neumann entropy becomes a measure of entanglement. Otherwise, you can use Von-Neumann entropy to as a measure of mixing. That is possible for whether it is a pure state or a mixed state. But the mixing and entanglement combination or this correspondence is there only for pure states.
Mm-hmm. Okay, sir.
So,
yeah.
Sir, he said previously that if we change the basis vectors, the row one, the form of the row one, the coefficients especially will change. Suppose, sir, is there any way, but the maximally mixed entangled state, the coefficient is for at least for two dimensional systems, it should be half and half only, right? So for maximally entanglement.
Correct.
Even if we change the basis vectors, we still should be getting half and half for the maximally entangled part, whatever basis vector it is.
Correct. For maximally entangled, there is going to be no change.
Okay, sir. So
it will be always half and half.
The coefficients of the maximally entangled state will remain the same even though the basis vectors will change, right?
Correct.
Okay, sir. So as long as it is in two dimensions, if it is three dimensions, then the coefficients will change.
I think even if it is three dimensions, then once you say that it is maximally mixed.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Then I think that coefficients will remain the same, but it is not as easy to see as in two dimension. But I think it is also valid in higher dimensions.
So it's like the for higher dimensional systems, the maximally entangled states should the coefficients of the maximally entangled states should follow some two criteria. One is that the summation of the coefficients should be one because it is a mixture and the second one is like it should all be equal, right? Each of the states.
Yeah.
It's like a priori probability kind of thing.
Correct. So such a kind of equal probability mixture is there, then I think that will be maximally mixed in all dimensions.
Yes.
And then that should remain so in all decompositions.
So I'm saying that the coefficients will change. For example, if it is three dimension, then it will be one third like that.
Correct. Oh. Ah, okay. That's what you are saying. Yeah. That's
yes,
it will be one third.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
So this maximally mixed state, actually, this is just, apart from the half, it is just an identity, right? So.
Correct.
So it will not change in any way. So.
Yeah.
Even that's in half dimensions.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, so I think if no other questions.
Sir?
You have any question?
Sir, I was about to ask about project meeting, sir.
Which one?
Project meeting, sir.
Project meeting, yeah. So maybe we can meet today.
What time, sir?
2:30.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, today 2:30.
Thank you, sir.